Good morning and welcome to the St. Jacob's Mennonite online service for July 26. Wherever you are, my wife Lori, son Isaac, and myself miss seeing you on a regular basis at church in the building. For those of you who are new or have not had the chance to visit our church, we welcome you very much. We are glad you can join us and our members during this online service. If you are joining us for the first time, I will quick fill you in on our summer series of the seven deadly sins. We have titled it Snakes and Ladders. We are coupling the sin each Sunday with the virtue that most counters the sin. We began with pride and humility, envy and contentment, and then greed and generosity. This morning, Mark and I will focus on lust and faithfulness. Lust and faithfulness. Hey Mark, was somebody joke to put two middle-aged married guys in charge of talking about lust? Oh boy. Well, that was my first thought that came to mind when we were going to be talking about lust. But then after settling down and talking to Mark about how important a topic this is and how little we actually do talk about lust, I felt more comfortable and willing to explore and talk about the sin, lust, and the ever so important virtue of faithfulness we need to continue practicing. So why is it that we can talk easier to others about challenges with greed, pride, and envy than lust? What is it about lust that is so much more secretive and hidden? How has our church talked about lust? God had created us and given us the feeling of physical attraction to other people. I suppose what makes this a tricky subject is that what one person is attracted to can be very much different from that of another person's desires. Throw in poor communication or the inability to express these feelings in a healthy, respectful conduct, the sin of lust can do much harm to many people and relationships. This Sunday's topic could be explored for months, and maybe we will have a continuation at some time on this sin. It is easy to think of the big names and scandals over the years relating to the Me Too movement, drawing much needed attention and reforms to justice systems to support victims of sexual crimes and prevent future sexual crimes, all driven by lust. But let's focus today on the more subtle and possible day-to-day trappings that could be driven by lust. To keep us from falling into these trappings of lust, we must focus our attention to faithfulness towards others. If we have a partner, we must respect them for who they are. It is very healthy to express physical attraction to your partner, but it must be done with a respect and consensual manner based on agreed upon boundaries. Likewise, in our workplaces and social gatherings, the way we interact with other people must be driven by faithfulness towards others in a manner of respect and not driven by lust. What may seem like a small comment on the looks of somebody at work can cause great harm and humiliation or even fear in the person it was directed. On the other hand, a comment to somebody at work about the way they carry themselves in a positive light can bring forward confidence building, a sense of respect in the workplace, and pride to the person it was directed. What we say and what we do projects a sign of faithfulness towards others if we talk and act with overall love towards all people. Bow with me as we gather in an opening prayer. Lord, gather us together in spirit as we worship apart. You created us as physical beings with many desires. You have taught us how to live with these desires in healthy, respectful ways. Give us the strength to keep us from falling into harmful, destructive desires, that we may enjoy a life of love given and receive from people all around us. Amen.
doing today? My name is Sam, and today I'll be talking about Daniel and the Lion's Den. But I also brought a very special guest to share it with you. Now, Leo, he was one of the lions in the Lion's Den with Daniel. Leo!
I'm coming.
Good boy. Okay, do you want to tell them their story now?
Okay.
Bye.
Hello. I'll be reading this story from the Shine Bible. If you would like to follow along, it's page 150. All right, here we go. Darius, king of Persia, had 120 satraps in his kingdom. They reported to three presidents. Daniel, a Jew, was one of these presidents. Daniel was very good at his job, and King Darius planned to put him in charge of the whole kingdom. The other presidents and satraps were jealous. They wanted to get Daniel in trouble with the king, but Daniel had done nothing wrong. So they came up with a plan. "Oh, King Darius," they said, "may you live forever. You should make a law that whoever prays to anyone but you must be fed to the lions." That's me. "Sign this law, O king, so that it can never be changed." The king signed the law. Daniel knew about the law, but he still went to his home and opened the windows, got down on his knees, and prayed to God. He prayed three times every day, just as he always had. The satraps and presidents came and found Daniel praying. "O king," they said, "didn't you sign a law that said people could only pray to you? If they prayed to anyone else, they would be fed to the lions." The king agreed. The satraps and presidents continued, "Daniel is ignoring you and your law. He still prays to his God three times a day." The king was horrified. All day he tried to find a way to save Daniel, but he could not change the law he had signed. So Daniel was thrown into the den of lions. That was the first time I saw Daniel. Then I heard the king call down, "May your God save you." I didn't know what that meant. All I knew is that I was hungry, and he looked mighty fine for lunch. But just as me and my pride were about to eat, we suddenly had a loss of appetite. My cousin said that he became a vegetarian, and I only started craving cupcakes. So instead of eating Daniel, we all had a nice chat about his God. The next day, King Darius came running down and called into the den. "Daniel, has your God saved you?" Daniel answered, "O king, live forever. God sent an angel to shut the mouths of the lions." I don't remember ever seeing an angel, but we lions did have a change of heart. Daniel was then brought out of our den, and King Darius commanded, "All people should worship the God of Daniel. This is the living God, enduring forever."
Thanks, Leo, for sharing that story with us. Now, kids, just like Daniel had faith in God that he would save him, we have to have faith that God will help us get through tough times, especially now. And remember, kids, God answers prayers and is always listening. Bye!
Come down and set God's people free.
This morning's scripture reading is 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 to 21. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Beloved, since God loved us so much, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and do testify that the Father has sent his Son as the Savior of the world. God abides in those who confess that Jesus is the Son of God, and they abide in God. So we have known and believe the love that God has for us. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness on the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, for fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not reached perfection in love. We love because he loved us. Those who say, "I love God," and hate their brothers or sisters are liars. For those who do not love a brother or sister whom they see, who have seen, cannot love God whom they have not seen. The commandment we have from him is this: those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also.
Where to start? Where do you start a sermon on today's topic of lust and faithfulness, the fourth in our hot summer series of deadly sins and holy virtues? I guess I drew the short straw. Kevin and Wendy are both noticeably absent this week, I think so they could avoid this topic when we set up our vacations and preaching schedules. Not that any of the other topics are any easier. And as Ryan said so eloquently, was this somebody's joke to put two middle-aged married guys in charge of talking about lust? Oh boy. Especially on a topic where we need the perspective, diversity, and voices of all genders. Where do you start into the topic of sex and sexuality? A subject no one really wants to talk about in church, in public conversation, in the presence of multiple generations. Around your kids, around your parents, a topic that can make us squeamish, uncomfortable, and embarrassed, even as we are curious, intrigued, excited, questioning and wondering about it and what our faith might have to say. Where to start in this online format when we are not meeting directly face to face? Interacting, sharing views with each other in community in the same way we had pre-pandemic, for a topic that is all about human relationships and how we interact with each other? Where do you start when we know some carry hurts and hang-ups and scars, pain that comes out of experiences connected to our sexuality, to violation, to betrayal, to the consequences of lust? Where do you start when the church has so often done a poor job talking about sexuality, or has obsessed about it in ways filled with shame, fear, disgust, denial, secrecy, and self-loathing. Why is it that lust made the list as one of those seven historic deadly sins, with sexual sin often named as the biggest of them all? The church has often been more concerned with rules and regulations and with who's in and who's out, rather than with a healthy and inclusive ethic and embrace of the potential of human relationships. We've had an impoverished theology of sex and the goodness of the gift of our sexuality. So where do you start? It matters where you start. I am not going to start with the vice this morning like we have in the rest of the series. I am not even going to start with the virtue, but rather with the foundational theme across this whole series, that of love. The series has been about the places where we have stretched or skewed or corrupted love in some way, and how through the various virtues we reorient ourselves back to love and the love of God. So why not start with love? We hear this original starting point in 1 John. Beloved, let us love one another because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God, for God is love. This is the foundation for all the virtues and for life itself. Then the passage goes on. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent his Son, into his only Son, into the world so that we might live through him. God became incarnate in our world. In other words, God chose to become human, to take on flesh in the form of Jesus. God was born into a body with all its fleshiness, its personalities and humor, its hurts and health, and all its passions and desires. By taking on flesh, God said that bodies themselves are still very good, as God declared in the very act of creation itself, made in God's image. And this is how God can show again what love really means, what it looks like. This goes against the strong strain in Christian history to separate body and spirit, to see one as evil and the other as good, rather than integral to and integrated with each other. Verse 12, no one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God lives in us and his love is perfected in us. Our bodies are where God abides with us, where God's love is made complete. God needs humankind in our bodies so that love can be made complete. What difference would this make if we celebrated the gift of our bodies as good in all their diversity and variation of size, shape, ability, gender, orientation, and expression? If we could feel at home within our bodies. Last Saturday, we met my parents and aunt for a physically distanced visit and swim at the beach at Valens Conservation Area. I was impressed with how each group on the beach stayed separate and safe. As I looked around, I was also struck by the huge diversity of peoples and cultures and family configurations, and yes, bodies of all shapes and sizes. This was not a crowd that was trying to impress others with the sensuality of their bodies. People were simply enjoying the sun and the sand and the water, at peace with the bodies God had given them, tall, short, large, thin, young and old, and everywhere in between. Our bodies are good. There's one more significant phrase in the 1 John passage. Beloved, since God loves us so much, we also ought to love one another. Having experienced love, having valued our very bodies, We ought to love one another, to respect, honor, uphold, and value the other. This is not just about us personally, but how we act and be in our world and for the other. It is about love of neighbor. I wonder if this understanding of love, of incarnation, of respect of the other, of the value of our bodies, can start to ground our understanding of sexuality. All of us humans are sexual beings in that broadest sense, in our embodied, diversely gendered humanity. This is more than the act of sex itself. It is how we live and are present in this world, and why this topic is so important and so personal. Toronto Catholic priest Ronald Rollheiser writes that sexuality is the hunger of the soul for wholeness, community, family, creativity, friendship, affection, and play. It is that drive to overcome our aloneness, to be in community and union with others. It is about wholeness. It is a gift from God. So too is sexual desire, arousal, and pleasure. It is a natural part of God's design for these human bodies we live in. Within relationships of commitment, faithfulness, mutuality, and respect, it can flourish and uplift, give life, and be a way to express love. It is a place where your most vulnerable self can be accepted and loved, where pleasure can be given and received in trust and intimacy and safety. It is a place of wholeness and a sign of this virtue of faithfulness. It is a good gift. This is so different than the messages of shame and fear and secrecy rooted in much of our Christian history when it comes to sex. Maybe instead of a sermon today, we should have simply had a public reading of the Song of Solomon with its joy, erotic pleasure, and celebration of sexuality. Karen LeBox writes, sexuality has to do with vulnerability, the desire for another, the passion that accompanies the wish for sexual expression makes one vulnerable. It creates the possibility for great joy, but also for great suffering. To desire another, to feel passion, is to be vulnerable, capable of being wounded. And I would add, capable of wounding others. Perhaps it is this vulnerability, this fragility, this very human part of us that also opens us up to be hurt or to hurt, to expressions of sexuality that move away from health and love and the very gift itself. As we are finding out in the series, vices are excessive or distorted attachments to good things. So it is with lust. A basic definition of lust is an excessive desire for your own pleasure, divorced from love and mutual self-giving. You reduce the other to an object, sexualizing them from afar, not respecting the other person as an autonomous human being. It is about using the other, about separation rather than union and wholeness and dignity or respect. Friedrich Buchner writes, sex is sinful to the degree that, instead of drawing you closer to other human beings in their humanness, it unites bodies but leaves the lives inside them hungrier and more alone than before. It is not valuing the other for who they are in their full personhood. It is taking advantage of that vulnerability. Lust separates us from our humanity and the humanity of others. It is not too much love, but not enough love. Lust is sinful, Bromley McLennan writes, because it devalues others as individuals. Lust isn't really concerned with the particulars of another, about his body or her interest or her consent. Lust is sinful because it fails the test of neighbor love. but it can also fail the test of self-love, too. Lust can take many forms or specific actions, sexualizing another, catcalls, cheating, sexualized comments in a workplace, pornography, leering, unnecessary flirting, unwanted attention, anything that takes away another's humanity. It can be as much about an attitude in the heart. It often begins more out of weakness than malice, as curiosity or strong desires carried away. Sexuality is powerful. People may not set out to hurt people or create scars in others, but it can form habits that separate us and move us away from wholeness. People become alienated from each other, and there is a loss of dignity and respect. It can happen for people within committed relationships or marriages or in singleness, to both straight and queer, to a range of ages and life circumstances. It can be momentary or habitual. It can affect us all. At the same time, in this series, we have claimed that practicing virtues can help us with our vices. What might the virtue of faithfulness teach us? Faithfulness has to do with candor, authenticity, telling the truth, commitment. Might there be a place for brutal honesty and confession, repentance, another kind of vulnerability to the other that can open the possibilities for a new future when relationships have been damaged? Is there a journey towards wholeness and healing that we take together, maybe with a partner, but maybe as the larger community? Can there be forgiveness, renewal, making things right? It is about restoring the humanity of the other. It is about recognizing that hunger for the soul of the soul, for wholeness, community, family, creativity, friendship, affection, and play, and finding healthy expressions again. It is the Holy Spirit setting us free. Within this whole topic, I do want to name the destructive results in both society and the church when lust has been intertwined with power and abuse, harassment, assault, and sexualized violence. We have heard the tough stories, mostly of males, of boundaries that have been crossed, of ministerial credentials revoked, of those we had respected violating others. We struggle when it is revealed after his death that the founder of L'Arche and champion of the disabled, Jean Vanier, is found to have abused at least 6 women over time. Or when there are multiple credible accusations of serial sexual misconduct and spiritual manipulation by hymn writer David Haas, whose workshop I attended in October. Emedo Media needs to make the tough decision to exclude his favorite songs from the New Voices Together hymnal. These stories are more about power than sexuality, but the sexual and personal damage is huge. The church too often has stayed silent, and situations have been allowed to grow, and victims have had no support or voice. They point to patriarchal theologies and hierarchies, secrecy, and whole systems that need challenged and changed. They are given a context to happen when the church does not talk in healthy ways about sexuality and our bodies and gender and power and, yes, lust. I do find hope when we have Sundays like today, when we can talk openly. Nadia Boltz-Weber is a provocative Lutheran pastor, writer, and founder of the House of All Sinners and Saints in Denver, Colorado. Her most recent book is Shameless, A Sexual Revolution, where she asks if there is an alternative to the Christian history of shame, guilt, and judgment when it comes to sex. She asks the question out of the very real lives of her congregation, so many of whom have been hurt or struggled with sexuality and don't fit the nice little boxes Much of the book comes out of interviews she did with her congregation, asking three basic questions. Growing up, what messages did you receive from church about sex and the body? How did these messages affect you? And how have you navigated your life now as an adult? In the working out of these stories and a theology around them, she gets at the gift of sexuality in our bodies that we have been talking about this morning. I like the framing she gives to start the book. A sexual ethic, or what she names sometimes as sexual stewardship or sexual flourishing, needs three elements. There needs to be consent, permission fully and enthusiastically given and received both ways. There needs to be mutuality, enjoyment by both parties, give and take, and the full respect of each other. Both of these are essential, and you will find them prominent in most sex education and places like the World Health Organization. Nadia Boltz-Weber adds a third, coming out of her Christian convictions. She calls it concern. She writes, "Concern brings us closer to the heart of Jesus' own ethic. Love God and our neighbor as ourselves. It requires us to act on another's behalf. It reframes the choice entirely outside of our own self-interest in a way that consent and mutuality alone do not. Concern means taking notice of how our sexual behavior affects others and each other. It is to pay attention, a concern for each other's flourishing. A sexual ethic that includes concern means seeing someone as a whole person and not just a willing body." This really brings us back to where we started, to the virtue of faithfulness, to a God who became incarnate in our world, who took on a human body, who showed us what love looked like, and that our bodies were created good. To Jesus, who said, "Love your neighbor as yourself," to a whole ethic of love. Let us love one another because love is from God and God is love. It matters where you start. I quoted MCEC Hamilton Mennonite pastor Alyssa Bender in my last sermon already, because she has had such great sermons on this series last summer. She speaks, "There is a good and healthy hunger in our soul to pay careful attention to steward and to question and to discern around. It is a hunger for wholeness, community, family, creativity, friendship, affection, and play. It shows up in our attractions and ideas and passions and desires that can lead us in beautiful, relational, faithful, and creative paths. We need to steward these movements and openings in our souls, though to continually ask, am I loving God and my neighbor and yes, myself? Let this be our starting point." Amen.
Love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind, and love all humankind as you would love yourself.
your soul and all your mind, and love all humankind as you would love yourself, and love the Lord your God.
As we gather again for our weekly worship, we want to give thanks for the offerings and generosity of this congregation. Last Sunday's theme of generosity is still ringing in our ears. I can give with joy. So let us give thanks for our offerings. Thanks be to God. For our prayer time today, I want to share a prayer of confession and lead a spiritual practice, both from our worship materials. So let us enter into a time of prayer, a time of confession. Loving God, we are a people filled with desires. Some desires draw us closer to you, others pull us further away. Some desires satisfy, others leave us wanting. We live in a world of unlimited, untamed, and unbridled desire, where around every corner there is temptation to satisfy merely our selfishness. We confess that we have followed too often the devices and desires of our own hearts and lost sight of what we truly long for, intimacy and communion with you. Forgive us, loving God, when we misplace that longing. Help us to see your face, feel your presence, hear your voice. Amen. The spiritual practice for this Sunday and this week is called the Prayer of Examine. This practice was developed by Ignatius of Loyola in the 15th century, the founder of the Jesuits. It is a way of, in a sense, examining your life over the last day, the last 24 hours, and asking where you felt close to God and where you felt drawn away from God. It is becoming aware of both the good and difficult experiences in our lives. Some people do this every night before they go to bed. So I will ask the two questions of examine now, leaving time for your own prayerful reflections. You may even want to close your eyes as you reflect. In which moments of your last day did you feel closest to God? In which moments were you led away from God? O God, we hold these reflections, recognizing those times when we are led away from you, giving thanks for the moments of closeness where we felt your presence. Go with us now into this new day. Amen.
My soul cries out with a joyful shout that the God of my heart is great, and my spirit sings of the wondrous things that you bring to the ones who wait. You fixed your sight on the servant's plight, and my weakness you did not spurn. So from east to west shall my name be blessed, could the world be about to turn. My heart shall sing of the day you bring, that the fires have exhausted your justice turn. Wipe away all tears, for the dawn draws near, and the world is about to turn. Though I am small, my God, by all, you work great things in me. And your mercy will last from the depths of the past to the end of the age to be. Your very name puts the proud to shame, and to those those who before you yearn. You will show your might, put the strong to flight, for the world is about to turn. My heart shall sing of the day you bring, let the fires of your justice burn. Wipe away all tears, for the dawn draws near, and the world is about to turn. From the halls of power to the fortress tower, not a stone will be left on stone. Let the king beware, for your justice tears every tyrant from his throne. The hungry poor shall weep no more for the food they can never earn. There are tables spread, every mouth be fed, for the world is about to turn. My heart shall sing of the day you bring, let the fires of justice your justice burn. Wipe away all tears, for the dawn draws near, and the world is about to turn. Though the nations rage from age to age, we remember who holds us fast. God's mercy must deliver us from the conqueror's crushing grasp. This saving word that our foremost heard is the promise which holds us bound. Till the spear and rod can be crushed by God who is turning the world around. My heart shall sing of the day you bring, let the fires of your justice burn. Wipe away all tears, for the dawn draws near and the world is about to turn. My heart shall sing of the day you bring, let the fires of your justice burn. Wipe away all tears, for the dawn draws near and the world is about to turn.
I invite you to hear these words of benediction. May you love one another, for love comes from God. We know that we live in God and God in us, because God has given us His Spirit. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God, and God in them. We love because God loved us first. God's love is the foundation our faithfulness is based on. Amen.